if you think of a Superfund site, a heavily toxic, polluted environment, you might think of it being far away and away from people. But in the case of the Gowanus Canal, it's right in the middle of New York City, surrounded by 8 million people, and really impacts a lot of human health. And we had no idea what to find. And when we got in there to look at the biology, it really kind of blew our minds.
Are you sure you're in the right place?
You know, we're here to meet Chris Mason from Weill Cornell. He's an expert on extremophiles, and he told us to meet him here, and I wasn't sure about that.
In the middle of Brooklyn to study extremophiles?
You know, that's a really good question that only Chris can answer, and a good thing that he's here.
Hi,
welcome,
Chris. Why are we here?
Welcome to the Gowanus Canal. This is a Superfund site in the middle of Brooklyn where we can actually find new extremophiles and new forms of life.
Tell us about the history of this place.
The canal was really just a trading creek, but it became more important for industrial use, so they dredged it and made it into a canal, which is the shape you see today. And then more and more industry, heavy industry, was built up along the canal in the 1800s. A lot of it was very much for coal tar and tanneries and refineries that were dumping a lot of their waste into the canal, hoping most of it would go back out into the ocean. Of course, a lot of it stayed here and built up a residue at the bottom of the canal, which created this sort of toxic sludge, which is what we're excited about today to dig into.
Once the sample has been sequenced, what kind of information do you get out of it?
We get all the DNA that's present. Anywhere from 20% or 30% to as much as 80% of all the DNA doesn't match any known organism because it's never been cultured before or it's never been seen before.
So what have you seen so far?
So not only do we get the species of what organisms are present and what genus and what species, but we can see that actually they're processing toxins out of the environment like acetone or toluene or volatile organic compounds.
Do you also see pathogens?
In the Gowanus Canal, we've seen a very limited number of what would be human pathogens. I think it's because the environment is so different from what you'd normally find on, say, human skin or human bodies. The biggest threat to the canal would just be the toxins themselves.
How do you manage to get all this done?
Really, the only reason a lot of it gets done is it's a team effort. So between the community labs and landscape architects and designers and scientists here in the lab, members of the laboratory really leading the project. Dr. Hénaff is the one in particular who's been leading the project from within the lab. So really getting a good team together to help get everything from the samples from the canal to extracted, to prep, to sequence, to analyze, and then write up the results. It all is a team effort.
How are the microorganisms distributed in the canal, and how are they stratified?
To give you a sort of visual, you can see if you look at sort of the waves here where we did the sample collection, when you go down a little bit in the water, it starts to get very, very silty and thick. When we sample, usually we'll take this tube and sample a little bit into the sludge. And we can see here that because essentially, you know, the levels of oxygen are going much lower as you get further down into the sludge, these are more anaerobic bacteria. They don't use oxygen at all, and they don't actually even use normal sort of chemical processes that you'd find for things that are on the surface. There are not only differences of prokaryotes and bacteria that are there, but of course the viruses change their diversity depending on sort of who they're hanging around with. They're controlling the ecosystem as well. There are these biosynthetic gene clusters, which are essentially clusters of gene that are positioned next to each other and co-regulated. Some of the organisms had clusters that looked like they could process toluene and actually, you know, use this to remove toluene from the environment. So we can actually see that these organisms are present, you know, being slightly controlled by these phages, having these enzymes created that actually can process toluene, all sort of one big ecosystem all working together.
I think it's a privilege that, you know, my function in society would be to figure out how things work. And I think that with that privilege comes a certain responsibility to make that meaningful. And so this is one of the kinds of projects that I feel I can concretely give something back to the community. It definitely came as a surprise, the fact that the bacteria have these pathways that encode the genes that are necessary to degrade the toxicity. That definitely came as a surprise, and I think it's actually quite beautiful that what we think of as the most unenvironmental of environments actually contains the solution to its own toxicity.
This is really, I think, a good template for how to engage citizen science as well as community. I think other groups can start to have, you know, some back and forth between community laboratories, designers, architects, scientists, all coming together to improve what's happening in cities everywhere.
So that was the right place after all.
It was, and you would never expect to see extremophiles in an urban environment like this.
Isn't it cool to see how many people were involved in studying them?
You know, sequencing is becoming so accessible to these community groups, to planners, that they can use it to monitor the environment. And that could actually be a great model for other cities to follow.
Yeah, really.